read it. I uploaded the slides already, so if you want to pull it up on your phone or laptop, feel free to do that or not. The agenda is kind of top down. I'm kind of starting with the philosophy of reliability and what that is, and then move downwards towards the techniques, and then kind of what my current focus is and what I'm going to work on next. So I think the concept of reliability is kind of abstract, and it's pretty context dependent, and so to kind of avoid a long philosophical description, maybe consider this case instead. So let's say you're using bpftrace, so you have a problem, and then you decide to use bpftrace to troubleshoot it. What you really don't want is a second problem, right? So you don't want bpftrace to do something unexpected or give you some wrong information, because that would kind of leave you on some kind of wild goose chase when you really have some more important things to get to. So that's kind of how I frame reliability for this talk, no second problems. So here I have some examples of second problems, and it's not like a complete list, right? You can probably come up with some more given more time. So the first one is like a clear example, or give a clear error if something is not possible. So it's a kind of constrained programming environment. The runtime is some restrictions, which is not super surprising. But we should at least give a clear error if something's not possible and not do something unexpected, like, you know, print out some kind of LLVM error saying the stack is exceeded or it doesn't verify, because once that happens, the user gets some kind of error message, and it's kind of difficult to reconstruct what bpftrace has done to your script, transformations it's done converting to bytecode. So if you get some kind of error like that, you have a second problem. Well, the second one is pretty standard, principle of least surprise. You should ideally not surprise the user with anything. So one example of kind of surprising behavior is, you know, long ago there wasn't a way to iterate over maps. So the only way for programs to print the contents of a map was to send a notification to user space. And the user space would be like, okay, I gotta print the contents, and it would print it. But that led to situations like, let's say you have map A equals 1, print map A, map A equals 2. But you're always going to get map A equals 2 printed because it's asynchronous, and it might not be super obvious to get that. But things have kind of changed, and then going forward, I hope we can fix this, and maybe we'll make that mistake in the future. And the third bullet point I have here is that misleading data is probably the worst outcome. People choose to use tracing tools over things like statistical profilers because they want to know about every single event, and not just like on average what happened, right? So if you lose some events in the tail, that's actually a big problem, because that's kind of the stuff you care the most about. So it'd be really great to avoid that. The bottom line here is that bpftrace is a tool to help you, and it is necessary but not sufficient. That a good tool is reliable, and so this is why we care about reliability. Challenges, right? Because otherwise, if there wasn't challenges, then it would already be, you know, really good, and we wouldn't need to talk about this. Well, let me say up front, this is not like a slide where I just complain about stuff. I would see it more as a, you know, slide of constraints. We have all these constraints we have to work with, and a lot of them are reasonable. We put together, kind of, we have to like assemble these data pieces to get something coherent out of it. So the first thing is, I'll give one example. Even the way LLVM is developed, packaged and distributed, is kind of a complex thing. bpftrace supports building static binaries that can statically link to LLVM, and that is tricky, and that's what kind of changes sometimes. I would say I probably spent at least, you know, like 100 hours working on that alone for many years. That's like something complex to deal with. There's other stuff like LLVM API. They don't have like a stable public API between different major version releases, but with every single major version release, stops building, and then you got to do a bunch of if tests, and you got to work around things, and sometimes they remove functionality, and you got to have all these weird paths. I will say that the latest LLVM release, LLVM 19, is the first one in our history that did not break anything. So I'm very pleased with that, and I hope that continues. The other stuff too, like LLVM IOs, are pretty subtle and tricky to learn. So one example is the get element pointer instruction, repeat. To learn, and it's kind of hard to wrap your mind around, and I always joke about getting a tattoo to my thigh so I can just look down when I need it, and then something to learn. It's not that bad. The next point, there's like language needs to be suitable for powerful enough for advanced use cases. But I think it goes without saying that language design is a pretty hard problem. I wouldn't say bpftrace is perfect. We try to improve it so that we have some guiding principles, and we'll try to fix issues as they come up and do our best not to make ourselves into a corner. The last three I'm sure you're all familiar with. I mean, the kernel is a pretty tricky environment. The kernel does a lot of complex things, a lot of different contexts things can run in. You might not be able to do everything you want everywhere, and you got to keep a bunch of things in mind. For example, we had this recent issue where if you have these specific probes, you're tracing spin locks, and you actually get an A to B A deadlock, and then you have to kind of work around it and know some certain rules, and then you just have to keep an eye on these things and keep them in mind when you develop features, which is kind of why it's complex. The next major bullet point is open source environment. I mean, we're at an open source conference, so I'm sure you guys are all aware of these things, but the bottom line here is that you kind of just have to work with what you got. Sometimes you don't got too much, so you just got to deal with it. And I would say maybe you do a pretty good job of dealing with it, but that would be up for you to decide. Okay. So given all these challenges, I spent a bunch of time thinking about this, and my opinion is that we should take a kind of holistic approach. And holistic in this sample of recent reliability issues that we've addressed. And you know, when I look at this, and even if you look at more of these, it's not obvious to me there's a pattern that emerges. There's not like one component inside bpftrace that could spend a lot of time and really shore up and get some kind of outsized reliability gains, which is fine. I mean, it's good and bad, right? It's good in that we didn't obviously mess up something too bad, but it's reasonable that it's a complex domain, so there's a lot of issues to deal with. For that reason, that's why I'm advocating for like a more holistic approach. So it's more than just looking at the code itself, because you definitely have to look at the code, but you also have to consider the whole development cycle, right? You design a feature, you implement it, you get feedback on it, you learn from your mistakes, and hopefully that loop gets tighter and you learn more and faster and faster, and you build on top of things. But if I put that principle into practice, my thought is I think CI is a really good investment to make, because you have to be kind of agile, you have to be able to address things. You may not have forced it. For example, CI has clear procedural benefits. It automates feedback, it improves development velocity, blah, blah, blah. It has different configurations. These are all great, because they all help mitigate known complexities. These are what you might call known knowns and known unknowns. Like a known known would be that with every LLVM release, that it emits will change. And so we deal with that because we know that'll happen. A known unknown would be that an API might be deprecated. But we don't know which API in advance. We have to do the whole matrix just to make sure we got a few. What I think is most compelling is if a property or a CI is properly done, and there's more on that later, it also addresses unknown unknowns. So you have a platform where you can sort of abstract way, you can encode and store domain knowledge that you've learned and you picked up. You know, personally, I'm pretty forgetful, so I want the machine to do the remembering so I don't have to remember it. And so if you can store all the stuff in the CI, it'll just indefinitely be remembered. CI is not free. It has its own challenges. I mean, these are some typical challenges. I'm sure there's a bunch more. If all of you have worked with CI, that's been like, unhelpful or unreliable or just plain bad. And I'm not saying bpftrace CI is the best thing ever. I've seen a lot of much better CIs. But I think for the investment in the scope bpftrace has, it's doing pretty well. It's like punching above its weight. For the next few slides, I'm going to share some techniques that we've kind of developed and we've had a lot of experience with, and we think that work pretty well. So Nix is a lot of things, including a language, an operating system, a package manager, a bunch of other things, right? But for this talk, let's just call it a package manager, because that's how we use it. The core of Nix, the way we use it at least, is a single file, Nix, right? This is a declarative file, it has everything we need, and from there we can do absolutely everything. One thing that you can do that's really nice is you control the entire dependency tree, right? So the whole dependency tree, you can apply a .patch file to anywhere in the tree. So say you wanted to patch the development. You put that patch, it's pretty sure what you do, and then Nix will just automatically rebuild everything that depends on it because it has the whole DAG. And really, really nice property. It's basically identical on every Linux system. It does not matter. And we've had pretty good experience using this. So people use all sorts of different distros and people are building this stuff and it works reliably. What this really means is that the CI is basically identical to your local machines. You can run everything that runs in CI the same as you can in your laptop. One other property that I really like is that anything you build inside the Nix environment, for example, like a dynamically linked binary, runs in the root host without any special configuration. It just runs like a container, right? If you build in a container, you link against like glibc, it could depend on your root host, you can't just copy it out and start running it. But with Nix, there's no such issue. You still can't copy it to a different host, though, because it does like some clever RPath things under the hood. It works really well on your machine. With different hosts, you have other things like we have app images. Anyways, the problem left is the app images. It's like a static binary, you put everything in there as a slash. And other things like lints, linters, unit tests, and stuff like that. So the CI that is only as good as it's best. So at the end of the day, if you have a really, really good CI, it's transparent and you just don't notice it and you don't know any issues, all it does is tell you when you're testing it. So this is kind of how I think about the bottom. The wider the thing, the more issues I expect to be caught. Narrow the fewer issues. It's not like a quantity or a time kind of thing. Like we don't, this doesn't necessarily say we have the most unit tests and then in this case it does mean that, but it's not what's intended to mean. Now we leave to our judgments, like we want more unit tests than run tests because unit tests run faster and they're generally more reliable. At the very top, there's actually something really interesting that I'll show you later. Here, kind of indicate current status for bpftrace is testing. Green means it's in good shape, there's a proper investment that's been made, I think it works pretty well. The orange means it's in progress, it's pretty close to being done, and we want it done pretty soon because it's pretty high impact. And then the red means it's not done yet, we haven't started, but we do want it in the future because it is. The next few slides, I'm going to kind of zoom into these elements and then I'm going to share. Where we're at with numbers, I wouldn't read into it too much because it's kind of arbitrary, but I'm just proof that we have a test. The unit test numbers are off because we kind of tend to prefer larger test cases, but there's like a bunch of cases. I would say it's probably closer to like 4,000 or something. So this is the first thing. We have a thing called runtime tests. These are basically end-to-end tests, and it kind of uses this concept of a mini-language. I think Russ Cox had a talk about testing in Go and how they developed the Go compiler and the standard library and stuff like that, and he says, like one thing he says, then he's like, oh, you can do a mini-language that makes writing tests really easy to write, and you can kind of extend it over time, and I think we found this to be really useful, actually. Like, initially, there was some skepticism, I think, even from me, but I think over time, this is really nice, because you can add a bunch more for this, you can say, like, on, hey, in this kernel version, don't run the test. If the kernel has this feature, run the test, and you can do stuff like that. And it's really just a pretty small Python script that parses all these things. It's really easy to read, it's easy to get started with, and it's easy to run. The bottom diagram is how the VM tests are going to be run really soon. I was going to get this done a while ago, but then there's some regressions I did to it. More on big strings in the BOF tomorrow. The general idea is that the outer thing is the VM the CI runs in, and then immediately on the inside is Nix, it has the entire environment and all the dependencies. That's why it runs in my laptop. Nix will also ship VM test, which is this tool that some others and myself have developed. It basically maps the current running user space into a VM, into the guest, but with the kernel flipped out. So the only thing you're changing is the kernel. And this lets you do a matrix of different runtime tests on the kernel version. This is super useful because then you can, like, target all of the LTS releases and make sure you didn't get them. VM test is also what bpftrace uses for the kernel. So left is kind of the test case. The right is the expected output. They're checked in as separate files. It kind of has a dual purpose. One, to review the changes, because a lot of times you make code gen changes, you just look to see what code's actually going to be generated. The right's the LLVM IR. That's what we generate and give to LLVM. There's some optimization done already. Not just by code gen. So what's highlighted here is, so that's actually the line we really care about. We really care that the bit shift is happening. Everything else is just noise. So I think in the long run, we want to be able to snip out all the unnecessary stuff. So if you've developed LLVM, you want, this is what's called we want to use that. So this one's really cool. You don't have to slide it up, and I was just pulling it up at some point, really squinting at this, because this is, I really like this. So with CodeQL, it basically lets you run queries on your code base at the source level. For me, this is the ultimate manifestation of encoding domain knowledge into CI. And so what this query does is catch a bug that we often reintroduce over and over. So for context, for AOT, it's this thing called ahead of time compilation. We want to serialize some structs to a file. So when we want to reconstruct them, we run this AOT bug. The serialization library we use requires that we reference the serialized members in this magic function. Pretty easy to add a new member and then forget to reference it in this magic function. And we've done this a bunch of times, and it's hard to catch. It's also hard to test, because how do you have a test for something that's not added yet? So what this query does is it finds all the structs that have some serialization going on, have members that are not being referenced. And so this query shows you every single member that's not being serialized, and because there's really good integration with GitHub, because GitHub bought this company a while ago, all these nice pop-ups for free on your files change tab, which says, hey, you forgot to serialize this one. Obviously, you can tune this over time to be more accurate. This is just one example of something you can really customize and really encode some stuff. On top of that, so CodeQL is a little to use. There's a lot of like magic implications of you have to like build a database, you have to install Java, you have to do all these things. But with Nix, we can reliably to all the developers without them knowing anything, right? But this script that just works. And so in that way, you can develop these scripts really easily, check them in, and it just lets you move really fast to the CI. So now this is all the stuff that I'm working on and is on my radar. So there's two of these. The first one is stack allocations. So BPF, as you may or may not know, has a fairly small stack. It's 512 bytes. So it's a really precious resource. In the past, we've been kind of lax with our stack allocations. We'll put possibly large things in there, and then that's not a good experience because if the script happens to allocate along the stack, then the user will get some message from LLVM barking about, like, oh, too much stack. Or the bad file say, oh, too much stack, and that's a bad experience. That would be a stack. So we want to move all the big allocations, all the potentially big allocations off stack somewhere else. So audited every single stack allocation call site, and I think we found all of them, and work is being done to move it all off onto a person for you. The next thing that's pretty high on my to-do list and on my radar is dropped events. So probes are not always safe to run in every context. That's actually fine, because it's a fundamental limitation of being in the kernel, and there's a lot of weird contexts. Events must be reported, though. We have to tell the user that we dropped any events. I think we have a pretty good handle on this one. I think Jerry is in the back there. He did some good work in the kernel and all this stuff a while ago, so all I got to do is talk to him and find all these things and plumb it in. Find a way to prevent future regressions. So that's on my radar. And the final thing I'm kind of looking at is aligning null lookups. So scratch maps typically one pattern to BPF if you want to work around the small stack is you want to do all your allocations in a pretty few array. But the null checks for these lookups, even if they're guaranteed to be inbounds, like you know it's inbounds, the verifier knows it's inbounds, but it still makes you do a null check and then have some code in the null branch. But the issue is that you have to put something in that null branch, and usually it's just a return. So there's nothing you can do if you can't like allocate a stack, right? Something on the stack. And this is a source of bugs, because if you get the code gen wrong, or you like didn't actually use the stack that was in bounds, you have a bug. And so metrics that let you, which is a better code to let you skip these checks and what this is twofold. One, it's a tighter contract between the user and the verifier. So basically, the user is asking the verifier, hey, this isn't actually an inbounds check. I want you to barf on me. And then right away, I have a bug. And that way, if it loads, I know there's no bug in this time. The other thing is the verifier can do less work because now you can prune all these dead catches. One thing I will say, though, is that yesterday we were chatting, and we're probably actually not going to use PressBP array maps for the off-stack allocations. It looks like global variables are a better option because they already have, you don't have to do full checks on them. And they also were added in, like, 2019, so they should be available on. So I think it's preferable to shipping something that requires it. That's all I have. Any comments or questions?
And go back to your slides. Loading of the stack local variables. You audited all use cases and you will be moving all of them to the map?
All the ones that are potentially large. So, like the small ones will keep there, the potentially big ones. Like for big things, they're like 1K.
What if you have a lot of small ones?
We'll have to hope LLVM has a good stack calling algorithm.
The point that I was going to make is that, like, it's not always to move it to per CPU if you care about the value, or like rather you, if you care about the verifier knowing the value of the thing on the stack, right? So that's the advantage of staying on the stack. Because you can track it to 1, 2.
That's a good point. I mean, so a lot of these allocations are just temporary. So we're trying to construct a big struct to plot the user space.
Probably ignorant about the ETF question, but I thought it was not possible for programs to run in contexts where it can be preempted. Is that true?
Well, an NMI is different from anywhere. You can attach a prod to an NMI.
So does that not mean that if you store data on a first CPU map and then you get preempted during the program, you can get things can go wrong?
Yeah.
Maybe like a self-charged map. Is that, does that exist?
There's some protections against this. So for K probes, I believe there's like the bpf prog active or something. We're kind of careful about this.
The map program. So you have two different programs. They each can use their own map. And then you, as long as like the same program cannot preempt it, of like for K probes and stuff like that, right? Like we do prevent nastiness for the same problem. Or like even across K probes.
I think it's a cost, yeah. And we have some protections for the
scope variables and BPF treasure scope probe with them scope, but as probe scope at the moment.
One area that I recall has been problematic in the past, or guys was kind of lying to users, was reading out bit codes. Has that been improved? Have there been any improvements with access to bit codes?
Like bit fields?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I added that a long time ago. I thought I got that right. But if there's a bug, yeah, let me know.
No, I was just curious if that has been reworked in recent weeks.
Yeah, I think in like probably 2019-ish, there were some bugs there. Like, it just wasn't supported right. It would just give you some junk, but I think I added all the hooks necessary to
do. Right, awesome. Do you do core allocations for bit field access?